प्रोफेसर राम रामास्वामी, फॉर्मर वाइस चांसलर, सेंट्रल यूनिवर्सिटी हैदराबाद. एंड एज यू ऑल नो दैट अ टीचर नेवर रिटायर्स, अ टीचर ऑलवेज फाइंड्स अ वे टू गेट टू द लर्नर्स. सो ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ हिंदी विद्या प्रचार समिति एंड ऑन माई ओन बिहाफ आई एक्सटेंड अ वेरी वार्म वेलकम टू यू सर. एंड it was a pleasure interacting with you, even though for a short duration. I have with us our new principal, Dr. Himanshu Davda. So Himanshu sir, the mic is all yours.
Sir has not joined, I suppose, madam.
I saw he said he is the co-host.
Yes, madam, I'm here. I was muted.
Yeah. Good afternoon, Himanshu sir.
Very good afternoon to you, madam. Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you, Director Madam. It's a pleasure being here with everybody, not only from RJ family, but also from our another very close family, that is IAPT. Our guest speaker for today, respected Professor Ramakrishna Ramaswamy, sir, IIT Delhi. Sir, thank you for being with us today afternoon for this lecture. A lecture series initiated in association with IAPT by Physics Department of RGC. I would like to take this opportunity in thanking IAPT for choosing Jhunjhunwala College, giving in fact this excellent opportunity to Jhunjhunwala College in participating this activity of knowledge transfer and knowledge sharing. It has been an enriching experience for all of us at RJ College, and we look forward to such associations in future. As the head of the institution, I would also like to take this opportunity in thanking my dear colleagues from Physics Department, especially Professor Rekha Ghorpade, for being instrumental in having this made available to the members of RJ teacher and student family. Because the benefits derived from the opinions and the comments of the experts go a long way, knowingly or unknowingly, in anything that we do related to the societal obligation as well as in our personal academic growth. So thank you, IAPT. Thank you, my dear physics colleagues. Thank you, Usha Madam, for being there for us, guiding us every time. And I now request Rekha Madam to continue with the proceedings of the ninth lecture in the series of IAPT RJC lecture series. Thank you, madam.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Himanshu, sir, for those kind words. Now I request my colleague from IAPT Mumbai Sub-Regional Council, Dr. Atul Modi, is a president of our Mumbai Sub-RC. I request Atul Modi, sir, to please say a few words about IAPT. Dr. Atul Modi.
Good afternoon, everybody. On behalf of Indian Association of Physics Teachers, Mumbai Sub-Regional Council, I welcome everybody for this lecture. I welcome Professor Ramaswamy and thank him for accepting our invitation for this lecture series. I would like to say a few things about IAPT. Many of you who have been regularly attending may already know. The others, it would be an information worth knowing. Indian Association of Physics Teachers, IAPT, was founded by late Professor D.P. Khandelwal with a aim of contributing to improving and uplift the quality of physics education in India. And as Mumbai Sub-Regional Council, we try to contribute in our own small way. The aim is to try and complement or supplement whatever is left out of the university and college education for students due to various reasons. Colleges have always been very welcoming to IAPT and supportive. Jhunjhunwala College is one such institution who have always been a great support to IAPT. Indian Association of Physics Teachers at all India level conducts pre-Olympiad exams, national standard examinations in physics, chemistry, biology, and astronomy, which becomes the preliminary round for selection of students for Indian Olympiad program. IAPT also conducts national graduate physics examination just to establish a quality benchmark for physics education at undergraduate level in India. And this NGP exam also is used by some premier institutions like National S.N. Bose Center, Kolkata, for admitting students for their integrated PhD program. This time, we could not conduct our summer program, which we always do for undergraduate students for about 2 to 3 weeks, mainly emphasizing the problem solving in physics, as well as trying to substitute some of the topics which are left out of the syllabus. And this time, due to lockdown, those activities could not be done. So the president of Indian IAPT, Professor Vijay Singh, he suggested that we conduct this lecture series online. And we were wondering how we are going to do that, because the Zoom session had to be arranged and all. And Jhunjhunwala College was, as usual, was there to help us out. And so they have coordinated all the activities for arranging communications, as well as supporting with the Zoom session and technical staff. And the physics department has been very active. So we thank them. We would like to start this session as early as possible. So over to you, madam.
Yes. Thank you, Dr. Atul Modi. May I request now my colleague, Dr. Kiran Kolvankar, to introduce our today's speaker. Dr. Kiran.
Yes, it is really a great pleasure to introduce Professor Ram Ramaswamy. He's a visiting professor in the Department of Chemistry at IIT Delhi. He did his BSc in chemistry from Loyola College, Madras, way back in 1972. Then he went to IIT Kanpur for MSc in chemistry. Then he went to the US. He did his PhD again in chemistry from Princeton University in 1978. Then he went to Caltech. He was a postdoctoral fellow there for 2 years. Then he came back to India. He was in TIFR for 6 years. And then he moved to JNU Delhi in School of Physical Sciences. He had many honorary positions. He was vice president and then president of Academy of Sciences. He was vice president of Indian National Science Academy. He was chairman, National Council of Rural Institutes. He was also vice chancellor of University of Hyderabad from 2011 to 2015. From there, he went back to JNU. In JNU, he had a position in computational biology and bioinformatics too, along with School of Physical Sciences. He has held many visiting positions. For example, University of Tokyo in 2010. Then he was in Institute of Advanced Study, Princeton in 2004-05. Then he was in Isaac Newton Institute in Cambridge University in 94, and also Institute of Molecular Sciences, Okazaki in 89-90. He has been honored with numerous awards. I will just mention a few. One of them is Indian National Science Academy Young Scientist Award. Then he was elected fellow of Indian Academy of Sciences, Bangalore. Then he was elected senior associate of International Center for Theoretical Physics at Trieste. Then he was elected fellow at Indian National Academy of Sciences. He was Santa Fe Institute International Fellow. He has received DAE Raja Ramanna Lecture in Physics in 2010. So as you see, he has so many accomplishments. He has published almost 200 papers. He has guided around 30 PhD students, and he has been on many editorial boards of journals. So I will not go into all the details. We are eager to hear him. Yeah. Thank you. There is one announcement for the participants. They should keep their mic muted and they can ask their questions in the chat box. We will try to answer them towards the end of the session. Over to you, Professor Ramaswamy.
Thank you very much, Kiran, Dr. Gorpade, Mr. Principal, sir, and other colleagues at Jhunjhunwala College and the Indian Association of Physics Teachers. It's a pleasure to be here today at this closing ceremony of your lecture series, if I understand correctly. Let me start by sharing my screen. And I hope this will work. Right?
Can see.
Yeah. Yes, is that all right?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Okay, fine. So the title that I chose when Kiran asked me to give a talk here was Chance and Chaos. And what I thought I would share with you today is some ideas relating to chance and to show you at least in some context how chance comes about. Now, chance, of course, is a very, it's something which is very, very common in our language. I mean, it's a word that we use a lot, but there is a precise sense of what chance means. We understand what is meant by a contingency, namely a contingent event is something that could happen, but it cannot be predicted with certainty. See, for example, it's an unfortunate example right now, the fact that that there was a disease called COVID, there was this coronavirus or COVID-19, it was known in December of last year. But that it would become a pandemic, it was certainly possible, but it could not have been predicted with certainty. Because if we had been able to predict it with certainty, maybe we would have done something about it, right? So chance is related to contingency, but you may define chance as the absence of necessity, namely the fact that something happens without necessarily having to be so. So one example which is easy to give is that if I have this pen and if I am standing on earth, if I drop it, that pen will fall down. There is nothing else that can happen because we know of the laws of gravity and we have let the pen go with no initial velocity. It has to fall down. There is no chance in this event. However, there are many, many other events that happen with a sense of chance. And in the physical world, nature around us, we know that chance occurs over and over again. It's a very famous book by Jacques Monod. It's called Chance and Necessity. It's a biology book. It's about his quest or his route to the Nobel Prize in biology. And he makes the statement that nature relies on chance and not on destiny. Okay, so I'll go on later to discuss how chance has played such an important role in nature. Now, one of the things about chance is that if this could happen and that could happen, maybe there is no such law. And as physicists particularly, we tend to like laws. So chance could be the opposite or the antithesis of all law. One of the ways out is to discover whether there are rules or the laws governing chance, and that's what I want to discuss in today's lecture. This latter statement is due to C.R. Rao, a great statistician who is actually 100 years old this year. Now, what is chance? we use chance all the time, particularly when you want, you know, want to start a cricket match or any other kind of game or what have you. You toss a coin. A chance event may be due to incomplete or imprecise knowledge, or it may arise from intrinsic fluctuations in the system. And these are two slightly different aspects of chance. But I want to just draw your attention to the coin that's getting tossed and ask, we toss the coin, and I have one over here, I'm not sure you can see it on your screen. And we believe that when you toss it, you should get heads or tails with equal probability, so that when somebody calls out either heads or tails, either person has a equal chance of winning, or an equal probability of winning. Now, this chance event, we believe, is governed due to the incomplete or imprecise knowledge. There are other instances where chance occurs through intrinsic fluctuations in the system. And as we go along, I may discuss both these aspects. Now, when you think of it, you know, as physicists, what is so unknown about a toss of a coin? In 1986, the mathematician Keller actually wrote a very nice article. It's in the American Mathematical Monthly. What is the probability of heads? And he, in the article, he asks, why is the outcome of a coin toss considered to be random, even though it is uniquely determined by the laws of physics? So here is my coin. It's a disc. It's a disc with a precise mass and a precise thickness. And I sort of start with my disc located over here on my, you know, next to my thumb, and I toss it with a particular angular momentum and a particular velocity. Why is it random? So what he does is he sets up the system over here. So that's my disk. The disk has got radius A. It starts out initially at some point. It doesn't matter. You know, in this calculation, it's taken to be A. It's at a particular angle. It's given an angular velocity, omega. It's given a linear velocity, u. Initial linear velocity is u. Acceleration due to gravity is g. And these are two equations which can be solved very simply. And that's the solution. Now, Keller's analysis is for a infinitely thin disk. And what he says is, the moment the coin hits the ground, which is the point y is equal to zero, it doesn't change after that. So if it's going to hit the ground with heads, it will continue to stay heads. So this is going to be true if the angle at time t naught, if that angle lies between these two limits, then it's going to show heads, right? And this can be, you know, solved very simply in a sort of a straightforward manner. Sorry, I won't, right? And I'm just trying to shift something on the screen. Okay, so the probability that it is going to show heads will be heads if this angle is lying between these two limits. And these two limits allow for the coin to have flipped n times, right? Now, if I choose the initial velocity and the initial angular momentum, the angular velocity omega and u, and I ask, how does this probability change, or, you know, when will it be heads? It turns out that you can do a little analysis and you find that omega and g by u are related in this hyperbolic fashion. So in all the black regions, the coin will hit the ground with this angle so that the heads will show. And for all the white regions, the coin will hit the ground such that tails shows. So the region of initial conditions is broken up into these regions, which are going to give you heads or tails. Now you can intuitively understand that if I throw it with almost no velocity and no angular momentum, then if I start with the coin showing heads in the first place, then it will also show heads when it lands on the ground. And that corresponds to a point over here. This corresponds to the point where it takes precisely one flip. Here it takes two flips and comes back heads. Here it is three flips and it goes tails, and so on and so forth. Now, So the analysis that that Keller does says that supposing we assume that the initial conditions are random and the outcome will be random. So if I take the initial conditions to be to have this density P of U and W, where U and U is the initial velocity and W is the initial omega, sorry, is the initial angular momentum. This probability of H, PH, can have any value that lies between 0 and 1. And if you can invert the problem and say that any value that you want over here can be got with an appropriate density P of U and W. For example, if I want it to be all of heads, if I want that probability to be 1, then I can choose my initial probabilities of U and W to be entirely lying inside this black region. If I want it to be 0, I can choose all the initial conditions to be entirely lying within this white region, and so on and so forth. I hope that that's intuitively clear. Now, they prove something actually much stronger. And the theorem says that if I take a continuous probability density with support in this entire region, in this entire positive U, positive omega region, and if I choose a point beta, if I choose an angle beta to be lying between 0 and pi by 2, and a constant U, then this integral, and I'll explain what this integral is. In the limit of u going to infinity, this integral takes the value half. Now, what is done over here is to shift u and omega to a point which is lying, so capital U chooses a point somewhere here, and it gives me a circle in this particular region. So as I let u go to infinity, this goes to very high velocities and very high angular momenta. And if I take a set of continuous probability density in that region, this particular integral has the value 1/2. This is exactly what we believe, right? We believe that the probability of heads is 1/2. But for this particular problem, it's not true that you can get 1/2 all the time. It is only true if your coin is tossed with sufficiently high velocity and with sufficiently high angular momentum, right? With sufficiently high angular velocity. This is, something that's worth thinking about, that, when you say that a coin toss is random, just when is it random? This problem has attracted a lot of interest, even in recent times. There's a paper by Mahadevan and Young in 2011, where they consider conditions. And then they found that as you allow something to bounce more than once, twice, and so on and so forth, then the probability of heads and the probability of tails, here is the case where you had zero bounces, here you have a few bounces, and here you have more and more bounces. And you can see gradually that the basins of attraction of these two heads and tails become more and more and more intermingled. They're not perfectly intermingled mathematically, but they can be good enough as far as physicists are concerned. So the main result of Capitania et al. Is that there is an open set of initial conditions for which the outcome is predictable. That is over here, this is all predictable. But as you increase the number of impacts, these basin boundaries becoming more and more complicated. And then in this case, you can consider the tossing of a coin as approximately a random process. So this gives us a very natural way in which chance occurs in physical systems. And a sort of a one-line summary is that you need to have coexisting attractors, and but more importantly, to have a sense of chance, these basins of attraction have to be intermingled. Now, let me try to wind up. It's been almost an hour. Now, chance and contingency have played a fundamental role in the natural sciences at very many, many scales. Whether you know it's the singularity of an event such as the origin of life, etc., or the way in which noise at a macroscopic level can influence outcomes, these you know chance has been very important. Now, many systems are complex, all right, and they are complex in the sense of having distinct dynamical states coexisting. In such systems, there is the possibility that small changes in the initial state can lead to large changes in the outcomes because these are nonlinear systems. And this gives rise to complex patterns in space and time. And by exploiting such complexity, a system can explore new behavior in responding to the environment. Chance actually plays a very major role in biology. Also in physics, and I'm not touched upon uncertainty in quantum mechanics, and it's not actually related to today's talk. But let me just conclude with drawing your attention that life itself is a game of chance. And the cause of it happens to be a matter of context, right? So as we are seeing how, you know, right now, our lives are so governed by the chance occurrence of a viral outbreak and the way in which it has just, you know, taken over the entire planet. All right. So chance signifies possibility, and thus it gives the event some kind of freedom to create. It's also right now, you know, evolution itself is a question of chance. And whether or not it derives from processes that follow deterministic laws, actually chance is a fundamental and unavoidable reality. This ought to be viewed as a good thing, and because if it was not so, then we would not be here to ponder the seeming improbability of our own existence. And with this, let me thank you for your attention and free to take questions.
Request Kiran sir,
with this
refer to the chat
yeah.
box.
Yeah, so there is one question already. How are bistable systems used in logic gates?
You see, if you have a thresholding system, all right. So if you have some option, if let us say a current is above a threshold, you go to one option, and if the current is below a threshold, you go to another option. There you've got a logic gate. Yeah.
Yeah. The next question is, according to Darwin's theory, it is stated that the fittest will survive, which is quite certain. So how chance works here?
How chance works here is that what is the fittest? See, you got to interpret what is the fittest will survive. That which survives is the fittest, right? It is not as if, it's impossible to give examples today without looking at coronavirus or COVID or what have you. You know, the fittest person is not the one who's going to survive this illness. So, in the sense that Darwinian fitness is not determined before the event, that which survives, in a sense, is therefore the fittest. A certain circumstance, that is the cause, that can make a particular thing the fittest. For example, when the when the dinosaurs were on this planet, they were huge range of sizes. But when the asteroid hit the Earth and whatever happened and led to the mass extinction, every dinosaur died except for those which became birds. And the thing that overtook everything was a small rodent-like animal. It was a small, the early mammals were really small creatures. Right? Now, what was the fittest? That was the fittest. All right? But it was not certain that that would be the fittest. Supposing the asteroid which had hit had also released a whole lot of, let's say, sulfur and nitrogen, which it probably did, but more than, supposing sulfuric acid was formed, maybe all the mammals would have died out and the only things that would have survived would have been fish life, right? So you've got to understand it in that complicated, slightly elaborate way. I just say, think a little more about it, because fittest is not determined before the event, it is only determined after the event.
Okay, so next question is from YouTube. Do fundamental laws in classical mechanics have limitations with respect to chaos regions?
The fundamental laws of classical mechanics don't themselves have limitations, but the fundamental laws can lead to chaotic motions, right? I'm not sure that I actually understand, what. See, the fundamental laws are, Newton's laws. It just turns out that the solutions to some of Newton's laws can be chaotic. So there's no sort of combat between the two. Maybe I didn't understand it correctly, but so you come back and write it down. I can see there's a question over here which says Feigenbaum's number, which we get from the logistic map, is a universal constant. So what are other such examples that give this constant? Well, in Feigenbaum's original paper itself, he considers the equation xn plus 1 is equal to k times sine of pi xn by 2 or something like that. All right, so that's one. Almost anything with a quadratic maximum will give you that same Feigenbaum number, and that's why it is a universal number. Yeah.
Yes. So the next question is, how is chaos theory related to stability?
To stability?
Yeah.
Well, chaos theory tells you about how things are unstable, all right? And any motion which is chaotic is in some fundamental way unstable. Namely, this is what sensitivity to initial conditions means. If a system is chaotic, then the smallest change will lead to a completely different solution. So stability, and if something is chaotic, in that sense, it is not stable.
Okay. So next question is, what can we do to reduce or minimize chaos?
And that's another set of talks. And there's a, you know, you should ask Professor Kolwankar to explain to you how to control chaos and how to do, how we can do these. There are very exciting developments that people have tried to how to reduce chaos and minimize it, how to make a chaotic system non-chaotic, all these things. These are all aspects of research. There are many things that one can do to achieve that objective.
Okay, I have a small question. I mean, sure. In saying origin of chance to bistability or middle basin of attraction, we are not considering any chaotic motion here.
Well, the thing is, Kiran, that as you know very well, unless you have chaotic motion, these attractor basins don't get intermingled. If you have non-chaotic motion, then it turns out that these attractor basins are smooth and their boundaries are smooth, and the question of riddling doesn't even arise. So if you don't have chaos, it turns out that the geometric properties of the basins are not, they will not allow you to be, to have this riddling. And then you go back to the case of Keller, where the regions of heads and tails are just these right, nice hyperbolic regions.
Okay. So looks like that's all with questions.
Okay.
I think Rekha madam can take over. Yeah. Thank you, Ram.
My pleasure, ma'am.
Thank you, Dr. Ram. Actually, it was a really great session. This particular lecture is not the end of this whole thing. Series in a, we are just having some collaborations with the colleges. So my college probably will be the last, but IAPT Mumbai Sub-Regional Council is going to continue this lecture series further.
I didn't mean to say this.
No. yeah. So thank you. Just, from IAPT side, I just would like to have this kind of.
Oh my God.
So we are going to continue this particular work series. Maybe we will start our collaboration with other college. Somaya College has already initiated and taken lead for voluntary in this particular series further. Even IAPT wish to conduct certain activities. Before that, I would like to call my principal, because this is going to be a last lecture hosted by our college, that is Jhunjhunwala College. Okay. So I would like to call upon my principal, Dr. Himanshu Davda, to sum up this particular series. Himanshu sir, if you are. Himanshu sir is not available on the net, may I request Usha madam to please sum up, madam, this particular.
Madam, after such an excellent lecture, you are speechless. Thank you very much, Professor Ram Ramaswamy, for that excellent deliberation. And whatever little I could understand, I tried my best, but since it will be also on YouTube, we will
tried my best, start
and go through it. Yeah. But nevertheless, you simplified it very well, sir. And especially, see, when it is tossing a coin, you only think about probability and nothing else. Yeah. But you gave a very good dimension and you tried to explain it in a very simple manner. And thank you so much. And that is a good, very excellent teacher in you,
which
made things very, very simple. And I think for all teachers, it's a lesson that we learn, that when you simplify something and you're able to communicate to your learner, I think you'll be very satisfied at the end of the day. So thank you so much for that.
My pleasure.
It was excellent, almost a feast for the last 1 month. We started on 11th. And today we are there, but I wish Rekha madam would continue because this is again a very unique opportunity where you are able to invite people all over.
Yes. Yes.
And if you have the timing being adjusted, maybe you will have speakers abroad also who would like to come and share with you. So in every crisis, you also find something good out of it.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise, people are so busy and they don't have time to come over. And even for us, the entire schedule is so packed that you only think about taking a lecture or a practical and then ending the day. So I think this is also like sharpening your tools and you are trying to learn, relearn and again go into the depth of the subject. So Ramaswamy sir, thank you so much for being with us and all the speakers who have come and given excellent lectures from different very good institutions, because for students this type of exposure also gives them an idea that with basic sciences there are premier institutions where very good work is being conducted and they have a great opportunity ahead. And the time is again for basic sciences, I feel. It was always there, but somewhere it got a little bit hidden with the...
No. We need more and more science if we want to solve problems like this pandemic. You know, it's not going to be done with just management. It has to be done with science.
Yes. So I think problem solving can be done only from basic sciences so that they go to applied aspect there. I would like to thank IAPT for collaborating with us, and collaborations are always forever. So I'm very sure we won't end with this. I wish that there could be discussion, like after this, if students and teachers again get back and see how they can incorporate some of these in the curriculum. We being an autonomous institution have that advantage of upgrading our curriculum. So once again, thank you very much and the entire physics department for organizing this series. But please don't stop it because learning never stops. So thank you very much once again. And thanks a lot for spending this evening with us. Thank you.
Thank all of you from my side. Till the next time.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. May I call Dr. Atul Modi, President of IAPT Mumbai Sub-Regional Council, to present a formal vote of thanks. Atul Modi.
Yes. Sir, I would like to trouble you a bit because there was one participant whose question came little late and that question got missed out. Question is there any relation between chaos and entropy?
Yes, of course, there is a relationship between chaos and entropy. And I mean, it's the ideas of entropy, because they have to do with probability and the way in which, they are used a lot in chaos theory. Let me just say that there is a relationship. It's one which is actively studied. And you can find a lot about it on the net. I won't be able to sit here and explain all of it, but yes, the idea that chaos and entropy are definitely related.
Thank you, sir. On behalf of Indian Association of Physics Teachers, Mumbai Sub-Regional Council, for this lecture, I thank Professor Ramaswamy. It was really a wonderful lecture. We do have this chapter on chaos and nonlinear dynamics in our syllabus. Mm-hmm. What you presented was a slightly different perspective, and it was really enriching for us.
Thank you.
At this point, I would like to thank all the participants for today's lecture. And there are many who have attended almost all the sessions. So to them also for making this program successful, for all the students who have really benefited out of these lectures. Junjunwala College, because I've been associated with them beyond IAPT. So thank you very much for extending the support and collaborating with IAPT for organizing this lecture series. For all those participants who are present here, we request that those who are not registered with us, as far as their name or email ID is concerned, kindly send an email to iapt.mumbaisrc@gmail.com. I repeat, iapt.mumbaisrc@gmail.com, so that all the future programs can be intimated to you. Mrs. Ghorpade has already announced it, we are going to have the second part of this series, which will be hosted by Somaya College, and we are planning to start it on, let's say, 23rd of July, which will be a Thursday. And of course, the official intimation will come, and we will follow almost the same procedure as we have been following. So, and I thank all my colleagues in the IAPT Executive Committee, Professor Mahesh Shetty, Professor Rekha Ghorpade, all the other members of Executive Committee, Professor Vijay Singh, for suggesting that we take on this activity during lockdown. Otherwise, we were actually a bit disturbed because we could not hold our summer program as usual. So I thank you very much once again to everybody. Please look forward to attend more sessions, which will be beginning from 23rd of July this month. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Atul. Thank you, Edwin. Thank you, Professor Ram. Thank you, Usha Madam. Thank you, all my colleagues and all my participants in the very wonderful participants. So thank you, each one of you. Thanks. I request host to please end the meeting.